Good Sunday morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to church. Good to see you. Don has put a sticky note in here. Please manage to get newsletter articles in as soon as possible next week, because she will be leaving next Friday after work to go to Colorado to be with her daughter as she delivers a baby. August is our month for the community clothes closet at the United Methodist Church across the alley. I believe Don put a sign-up sheet over there in the west wing on the table. So please take a moment and sign your name to that. Souls for Souls. Wow, that is great. They boxed up our first shipment of shoes. 12 boxes. That weighed around 50 pounds, correct?
It varies,
okay. So 12 boxes of shoes we have sent so far. And this goes to the first part of September. So continue to bring your shoes in. That's awesome. Thank you for signing the sheet for lawn mowing. We only have like 5 slots left for the season, so awesome. Thank you. And Vacation Bible School, Globe for Jesus, August 2nd and 3rd for ages 3 through the 4th grade. And that's 2 nights. Let's see. Trustees meet Monday evening, tomorrow at 7 p.m. Yes, there's Bill and Doris brought in zucchini and cucumbers, and they're in the west wing as well. So please take them, or you might get one in your mailbox. So just spare the pain, okay? All right. Anything else? Oh, the red books. Take a moment to sign those and pass them on and put the page in the offering plate. Let us prepare our hearts and our minds for worship.
Be as righteous as you are able for the call to worship. Are you weary from the stresses of this week?
Weariness and stress are our constant companions.
Let the love of God wash over you, relieving your stress and weariness.
We praise God for such abundant compassion.
Let the word of God enter your hearts and spirits, giving you hope.
May our lives reflect God's abundant love and peace.
Let us join together to sing hymn number 62, O for a Thousand Tongues, page 62 of your hymn book.
Thank you.
God of grace and God of glory, come and be known to us in our gathering together. Come and be present in the songs we sing and in the prayers we raise. From the busyness of life, we come to find once again that you are always present and always ready to receive us. As we affirm our faith this day, deepen the roots of our commitment, that we may learn your calling upon our lives. Surround us now with the love and comfort of your Holy Spirit, and the direction and redemption of Christ Jesus. Amen. Today's reading is from Romans chapter 8, verses 1 to 11. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit of life set me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law was powerless to do, in that it was weakened by the sinful nature, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh to be a sin offering. And so he condemns sin in the flesh in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fully met in us who do not live according to the sinful nature but according to the Spirit. Those who live according to the sinful nature have their minds set on what the nature desires, but those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their minds set on what the Spirit desires. The mind of the flesh is death, but the mind controlled by the Spirit is life and peace. The sinful mind is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. Those controlled by the sinful nature cannot please God. You, however, are controlled not by the sinful nature, but by the Spirit, if the Spirit of God lives in you. And if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, they do not belong to Christ. But if Christ is in you, your body is dead because of sin, yet your spirit is alive because of righteousness. And if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who lives in you. Here ends the reading of the Holy Scripture. May the Holy Spirit lead us where it will.
So last week as I preached, I mentioned the 8th chapter of Romans because the 7th chapter of Romans sets up this next chapter called chapter 8. And so that's where I'm going today. I'm going to take you there where there is plenty of food to nourish the soul. The previous 7 chapters, in fact, had focused on the power of sin in our lives. And these 7 previous chapters set the stage for chapter 8. For 7 chapters, we've heard about sin, the ideas that Paul has about sin. We can't escape it. It's like our shadow, and we never get rid of the shadow. Or we can't pay for the penalty for our sin. Or last week, that which I want to do, I do not do, and that which I don't want to do is precisely what I do, because of the power of sin in me. And Paul concludes that whole section of chapter 7 saying, what a miserable person I am. Then he adds this transitional verse. Who will help me escape the bondage and power of sin in my life? Thanks be to God for our Lord Jesus Christ. So today we move into more of a positive topic. If you remember back from last week, what was the one hopeful word I laid out for chapter 8? Do you remember? Can you remember that word? The Spirit. The Holy Spirit. The Spirit of Christ. God's Spirit. These words are all used interchangeably. So we get to chapter 8, it says, if Paul opens up the fire hydrant and all the water gushes out. Or perhaps it's like releasing a valve on one of the geysers at Yellowstone Park. The water just rises up and flows. So suddenly here in chapter 8, Paul turns the faucets on. Full blast. For 7 chapters, there has been silence about the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit. But in chapter 8, we hear 21 specific references to the Holy Spirit. That gushing of the Holy Spirit. Like a release of water from the channels of a high dam. And the water comes swirling out of those channels with a thundering power. Such is the power of the Holy Spirit. 21 times he mentions the Holy Spirit and directs our attention to that transforming power of the Holy Spirit for our lives. This chapter is a high watermark, if you will, of Paul's whole theology and perhaps all of his letters. This chapter is the most rich and hopeful of all of Paul's chapters. This chapter is the most practical, too, in showing us how important the Holy Spirit is to our daily lives. He lets the Spirit flow. I will always have a fond attraction to chapter 8, because the pastor at my confirmation used chapter 8 as my confirmation verses. Always been a part of my life. The Holy Spirit, too, been a part of my life. So today's sermon is going to focus on what it means to set our minds on the things of the Spirit. What does that mean? We know the mind is powerful. The mind influences everything in our lives. For the Apostle Paul, the mind is the controlling center of the human being. And the mind controls both the body and the emotions. We know that our minds control or direct our bodies. My brain tells my fingers to move. My mind tells my arms to go up. My brain tells me to wrinkle my nose. The power is in the mind. The Apostle Paul tells us that the mind is the controlling center of all of the physical actions, all of our emotions. So Paul wants the Spirit of God to enter our minds and transform our minds. And therein, transform the way we think, the way we act, the way we feel. Paul underscores that it's crucially important for us to have the Spirit of Christ living in us. If Christ's Spirit does not live in us, neither does Christ. When Christ is in you, your spirit becomes alive because of righteousness, because of right relationships. And if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through the Spirit. The Spirit that lives in you. Paul works with the idea that God's Spirit raised Jesus from the dead. And that same Spirit that raised Jesus' body lives in you and gives life to your body and your personality through the Holy Spirit that lives in you. The Spirit of Christ lives inside of us. And that Spirit empowers us and transforms us like water released through those floodgates beneath the dam that creates electricity and power. The Holy Spirit gets inside of us, wakes us up, and we start to move and come alive spiritually. That is the way of the Holy Spirit. When the Holy Spirit gets inside of us, we wake up, we start to move, and Jesus comes alive in us. That is what the Holy Spirit does. The Holy Spirit makes Jesus come alive in us so that our minds start to think like Christ, more like Christ anyway. The Holy Spirit is the invisible power and the invisible presence of God living inside of your spirit and mind. And that invisible presence and power controls and directs your life. The Holy Spirit affects the way we think, the way we act, and the way we feel. We are just coming off the 4th of July, so imagine you have two sparklers. As a kid, I remember lighting or having a sparkler lit, and then I would run around the yard trying to touch like wood or different object, grass or whatever it would, and start another fire from that sparkler, as a kid would. But when I touched the lighted sparkler to another, to any of those objects, nothing happened. Nothing caught on fire. But if I took that sparkler that I had in my hand and touched another sparkler, it would ignite. Why? The two sparklers were made of the same thing. They were made of the same nature. They were made of the same combination of elements. Such as it is. We are like God. We are not God, but we are like God in that we are made out of the same stuff as God. We are made out of the same substance of God. God's Spirit sets off our spirits inside of us. And when God's sparkler touches my sparkler, it sets my sparkler on fire. Why? We human beings all have this divine spark in us, the divine glory in us, even though some days we don't see it, and that divine radiance in us. And so God's spark was in the person of Jesus, and he ignites us. Wood won't do it. Glass won't do it. Metals won't do it. Other fire will spark the fire in us. In the analogy of the sparklers, the fire from the lighter was God. The first sparkler was Jesus. God set Jesus as the Christ on fire. God ignited the fire of the Holy Spirit in Jesus. Jesus and God were of the same nature, the same spirit. And that sparkler was symbolic of you and me. Jesus' fire sets us on fire. We are made of the same stuff. We are spirit stuff. And God ignites that fire in us. And if we have a third sparkler, and the alive, burning spirit in a Christian makes contact with it, it ignites the spirit in another person. So it goes on and on. And the fire of Christ in other Christians will also set us on fire. That spirit in us. That's why we hang around other Christians. That's why we come here as a fellowship, as a faith community. The fire in them lights the fire in us. Just like good friends who inspire us and help us to be better people by their example. We are fire. We are the divine spark and the divine fire in the lives of other people who helps keep the fire burning in us. The two sparklers help teach us that we and God are composed of the same stuff, the same spiritual stuff, the invisible spirit of God and the invisible spirit of the person, each of us as the person. As Romans 8 says, when Christ is in you, your spirits become alive. Another way of saying this is that a person is composed of a mind, physical body, psychological emotions, and spirit. Look around the globe and aware of all the religions of the world. If you look around the world and all those different religions, you can come to the conclusion that spirit is an essential component of the composition of those other traditions as well, and part and parcel of us being created in the image of God, the Imago Dei. Human beings have spirit in us, and Paul wants the Spirit of Christ to enter our spirit and renew our minds, to transform our minds. Christ's spirit affects the way we think, the way we act, the way we feel. Where do I get the spark of Christ lit inside of me, you might ask? From Christ. From wherever Christ is to be found. In the Word, in other people, in the sacraments, in prayer, reading Scripture. Romans 8. The faucets are turned on full blast. The water hydrant is open. The water shoots out. But the geyser shoots off a spray of water into the sky. The water fountain is flowing with water. And Romans 8 is the high point, the apex, the mountain top of Romans. I think it's probably the best chapter that Paul ever wrote. Thanks be to God. Let us join together and to God be the glory.
Thank you.
As we come to our time of prayer this morning, may we be mindful of all those persons who have listed on our prayer list this morning. Are there others who need to be named to the prayer list or joys and celebrations you'd like to list out?
A very long time friend of ours, Jackie Luckstead, lives near east of here, recently discovered that she had a brain tumor, and brain operation was scheduled for Friday. We don't know what the results of that operation are, but prayers for her and her family as they face challenging days ahead. Let us be in prayer now. Good and gracious God, as we awoke to this new day, the sky full of sun, and giving thanks for the rain that refreshes the face of the earth, the rain, the water that gives us life, we give you thanks and praise your holy name. We give thanks also for all those persons in our lives, our families, our friends, who make such an impact. Who sometimes change our lives with their positivity and the example that they live their lives. And in all of that, we give thanks for your unfailing goodness, gracious God. Out of every good promise, there is hope and life. Embrace us in your care, gracious and loving God. Embrace all who seek you through the issues of poor health, fear, the anxieties that come with making hard choices, and through life transitions. We pray, too, for those whose lives are crowded with umpteen expectations, broken relationships, abuse, loneliness, and uncertainty. And those also who struggle in grief and sorrow and loss. For your guiding hand through all our days, we pray for our church, too, that its ministry will grow. We pray for our servicemen and women whose lives are always on the line. Listen now to the prayers of our hearts, gracious God, as we lift up Jackie and family and Lisa and Dale and Brenda, Carl and Tanya, Sarah, Ken, Lulabelle, Eva, Dan, Jeanette, Rosella, Herb, Nick, Don and Phil, Bill and Betty,
country, Kelsey, Ian, Adam, Abigail, Matt, Rose, Madison, Utana. We lift up to you also the well-being of our country and our world. We give all these spoken and unspoken prayers, gracious God, to you in faith. We lift them to you for your cares, for your healing, and your keeping. We pray this prayer and the prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Forgive us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Hear our prayer, O Lord. Gifts that God has blessed us. Many are the ways in which we can give thanks. Let us make our offerings as a token of thanksgiving. I would invite Dishes forward to receive this morning's offering.
Mark.
Thank you.
Before you, O God, we offer our prayers, our presents, our gifts, and our service. We lay our gifts before you in praise and thanksgiving for your many blessings. May these offerings continue the transforming work of your Spirit in and through our congregation. Let us join together in closing hymn, "Every Time I Feel the Spirit." Express my deepest gratitude to this church and the years that we've had together in ministry. It has blessed me and Susan so deeply and richly. So I can't think of a more fitting place to retire than from this church. Our immediate plans are to stay in Amherst. We want to be like Ravenclaw. We're going to stay in Anamosa. We'd like to come back and be members of this church if that allows. We are home here. We are at home at First Congregational. So, after that time, that lapse of time that we all need to take as pastors stepping away, our blessings and prayers are with you as you call. God's great love and rich mercy have been made alive in us, made alive in Christ. Let us go now in peace to live lives of grace and to do good. Let all God's people say, thanks be to God.